The following is a presentation of the Matt Talk Podcast Network. It's time for Inside Virginia Tech Wrestling. We'll talk all things Hokie wrestling with Coach Tony Robie and staff. Now, let's join your host, Hall of Fame wrestling writer and broadcaster, Jason Bryant.
Episode 69 of Inside Virginia Tech Wrestling. A new school year is here, but what's not back is hair on the top of Coach Tony Roby's head. Coach Roby, another year of school starting in Blacksburg. What's move-in day been like for you in Hokie Nation?
Move-in day was last Wednesday, and I was actually on the road recruiting a little bit Tuesday, Wednesday of last week. So, which is a good time to be off campus, to be honest with you, because moving day is, it gets pretty crazy and tough to maneuver around campus, on and off campus. Parking is awful and has been awful for the last week or so. It'll get better as we roll a little bit further into the fall, but it's exciting, you know. It's another year of Virginia Tech wrestling, which is my 13th, so I'm pretty fired up about that and excited about the season and to get rolling and get everybody on campus.
Yeah, and this year you don't actually have to do move-in day with your staff because you guys are in place, nothing's changed, you're set to go, you've settled into a groove, and you know what's been different and what's been kind of the same from this year to last year with the staffing changes. You guys were just getting used to each other in a full-time scenario, so what's it like being here starting year two?
I think that there's a much higher comfort level between all of us, and I think everybody kind of has settled into what their role or their roles are with the program and you know, in the wrestling room and in the wrestling office and on the recruiting trail. And I think as we've gotten to know each other better over the course of the last 16 months or so, I think you start working well together. You learn each other's strengths, each other's weaknesses. And, I will say that, we've gotten to know each other a lot better, and I think just our families have gotten to know each other a lot better, and we've built pretty strong relationships. So it's nice to come into work every day and feel good about the people you're around, and knowing that everybody's on the same page, pulling in the same direction, and working for the same goals. So that's certainly for me personally, that's made my life a lot easier, and I think it's allowed me to do a better job as the head coach here at Virginia Tech.
Moving into July, because the last time we spoke was at the end of June on the last episode. In July, you've got busy with camps. You've also got Fargo. Let's just break down how July went for not just you, but the entire Hokie wrestling staff.
Well, we have all of our guys, including incoming freshmen, are on campus, either taking class or they're working our camps. We had our team camp in the indoor football facility here at Virginia Tech, which is about 3 years old. is an awesome facility. We're very grateful that they allow us to use that for our team camp. We had about 24 teams that have participated in that, and our numbers were up significantly from last year. So team camp, for anybody who's either attended or has run a team camp or been a part of it, understands what kind of work you have to put into it on the front end. Once it's up and running, it's pretty easy to do. We pay some guys. Larry Hall does a great job in helping us with that, and some other people. But we once it's up and running, it's easy. But on the front end, getting it organized, making sure check-in goes smoothly, and making sure we're organized and ready to roll when that day hits is a lot of work. So I think as a coaching, that's certainly one thing that we're still kind of learning. At least Jared and Frank are learning how to operate and manage a team camp and our camps in general. But certainly busy time in July with that camp, and then we do a couple 30-man training camps. We do a skills and drills camp. So in all, we probably had 500 kids on campus through the month of July, which we were pretty happy with numbers-wise. I made the trip out to Fargo for a few days out there and was able to watch some great wrestling and watch some guys that are verbally committed to us that had some pretty good showings out there that we really can't discuss a lot, but was excited about their efforts and kind of the future of VT wrestling. I think people that follow that feel feel pretty good about the 2019 class coming in at Virginia Tech.
Yeah, it looks pretty impressive. I want to roll back to the camp situation, because wrestling is unique in the situation. You talked about skills and drills camps and training camps and then team camps. For those who are unfamiliar with how a camp structure works, so what exactly is a team camp for those who are unfamiliar?
It's basically just a tournament. I wouldn't say just a tournament, but that's the, more or less that's the concept. Is most of the kids that attend that camp attend with their high school team. We do have some kids that will come as individuals that will place on teams and fill roster spots, but they wrestle 12 dual meets throughout the course of camp. There's about four or five technique sessions. They'll wrestle an individual tournament, and we do an all-star match that's associated with that. So in all, the kids get anywhere between, I would say, 12 and 20 matches. So from a competition standpoint, it's really tough to beat that, getting that kind of mat time in a 3-day or 4-day period of time. So we combine that. And there's also, I think for the high schools and the high school coaches, they like it because it helps them create unity and team bonding. And it's a good team building experience for them going into the next season. And it's really good for a lot of their younger guys. I think that's why a lot of coaches like it. If you're one of the best guys in the country, it's probably not the best camp for you. But if you're just your average, typical high school wrestler, it's a great way to compete, get better, learn some technique, be around your teammates and your coaches in a competitive environment. So it's been a really successful camp for us over the years. We peaked a few years ago and had, I think, 34 teams. So it's a pretty cool event. Like I said, it does require a lot of work on our end, but the end product, I think people are pretty happy with.
And is it typically teams from Virginia, or are you getting a swath of teams from around the region in the country?
We really get them from all over the place, up and down the East Coast. We get South Carolina, North Carolina, obviously a lot of Virginia, West Virginia, Maryland, Pennsylvania, Ohio. We've had teams come as far as, upstate New York in the past. So it is as far south as Florida. So, yeah, I mean, it's good. And we break the teams up into two different divisions based on the quality of their team or where they're at. So what we try to do is make sure that they're getting matches against teams that are kind of similar caliber and that there's not a lot of discrepancy in who they're wrestling.
Now, when you go to a technique or a skills and drills camp, define the differences between that and maybe the type of teaching you're going to get at a team camp.
A team camp, there's not nearly as much technique. I mean, we have Coach Molinaro, Coach Frey, or Coach Walls, and guys that are, Zach Zavadsky, McFadden, myself, teaching at really all of our camps. But a technique camp, we call it a skills and drills camp, is just exclusively technique. There's a little bit of live wrestling, not a lot of live wrestling. I think it's geared more towards kids that are just starting out in the sport of wrestling. We go over a lot of fundamental basic stuff. Obviously, we'll add some progression to that and add some more scoring attacks and try to build it up into some stuff that's a little bit higher level. But for the most part, it's for kids that are new to the sport of wrestling or beginners, maybe elementary school, middle school kids primarily. They're just here to learn wrestling skills. And then we also do a training camp. We call it a 30-man training camp. A lot of camp systems use the word intensive training or the words intensive training to describe theirs, but that's basically what it is. They come in, they train, they get to wrestle with Virginia Tech guys, they get to get put through college workouts, and it's a kind of a combination of all three. They get a lot of competition and hard wrestling. They get conditioning and weight training and running sprints. And we take them over to the football stadium. They get to run in the football stadium. And they also get 3 to 4 hours of technique each day. So that's geared for kids that are really serious about the sport of wrestling, maybe kids that are interested in wrestling in college or maybe wrestling at Virginia Tech to get a feel for what it's like to be a college wrestler and what these workouts are like and just kind of see if it's for them. But it's definitely helps kids prepare to win state and hopefully national titles more so than maybe the technique camp does.
When we look at the kids that are coming to campus, like you'd alluded to, that it might be a chance for them to see the campus. But when the old days of recruiting, really before Flow Wrestling, before the internet, These type of camps were really crucial in getting your eyes on kids and seeing them more than just, you know, one match at a tournament or go to their state finals or something. I mean, how has the landscape changed, but still how relevant are camps to the recruiting world?
I encourage a lot of kids that, you know, or maybe not the kids that are the top kids in the country that are ranked in the top 100 recruits in the country, but kids that maybe are looking to really make an impact on us and catch our eye. And if they're interested in coming to Virginia Tech and wrestling here, and maybe we don't know who they are, if they've just had success on the state level or the regional level, more so than the national level, maybe kids that we don't know, if they want to get on our radar, it's a great way to get on our radar. We've picked up a ton of kids over the years that have come to camp, and that's kind of where we saw them, and they caught our eye. Just something about them, whether it was their work ethic, whether it was their ability in the sport of wrestling, or we just kind of had a connection with the kid, have ended up coming to Virginia Tech and really have helped us a lot. I mean, Pete Yates was a kid that I caught on to at a camp that we were doing down in Georgia at the time. Chris Penny was a kid that we caught on to at camp. Chris Moon and all those guys had really good careers for us. And those are just a few that I can think of off the top of my head. But we have several on our team now that were campers as well.
Yeah, I remember talking to Peter Yates down at the convention. We'll get to the convention discussion here in a minute. He was like, yeah, nobody knew who I was in high school. It's like, because I run into him, he's working with Compound. I'm like, yeah, you were what, Salem, right? He goes, yeah, nobody knows anything about Salem High School in Georgia. I says, well, there's two Salems in Virginia that I know about. One's the Sun Devils, and the other one's actually in Salem. I think they're like the Maroons or something. I should know that for as much time as I've spent in the city of Salem back in the old single-A, double-A state tournament days. But towards convention, there were a number of discussions that were relevant to the Division I landscape, one of which was a discussion about legislation that's come through for football and how that could impact other sports, specifically, you know, in our case, wrestling, and the number of games that you can compete in Division I football and not lose your red shirt. Automatically, I think right away, wrestling people are like, oh, this would be great for us. Greg Dana from the NCAA and Anthony Holman from the NCAA were there kind of explaining how legislation works. And to go through the process, you've got to usually have a conference sign off on a you know, piece of legislation that it goes through. It's not like we're going to see this next year or this year, but it is a possibility, but it's got to be introduced. So with that, all that paperwork out of the way, what are some things that you see that could be beneficial or, you know, the other way around if wrestling kind of follows all right, we got a set number of dates and you preserve your red shirt type of situation?
Yeah, no, I think that most of the wrestling coaches are in favor of this proposal or this rule. And I think for a lot of reasons, there's a lot of schools that have roster caps. I think the weight classes play into it. It's difficult to have depth at all 10 weight classes for a lot of programs. And, you know, when you're redshirting a guy and somebody gets hurt, sometimes it gets difficult to fill that weight, and then you see some forfeits in some cases. And I also think from a fan standpoint, it's, you know, I think a lot of our fans would have loved to seen Makai Lewis wrestle one or two times or three times last year during the course of the season. So it adds a lot in that sense. I do think we have to be a little bit careful. In my opinion, I'm not sure that I want to see that rule be in play for conference dual meets, obviously for any postseason events, but there's a lot on the line for your conference dual meets as well. So I think non-conference dual meets, it would be a great thing when there's probably not quite as much at stake. But once you get into conference play, conference wrestling, you know, I think you should, if a guy is going to redshirt, that, you know, he should be redshirt. And if he does wrestle in any of those dual meets, that would burn a year for him. That's just my personal opinion.
What about in the situation? Now, here's one thing I look at it and I'm like, you know, we're obviously pointing out like the blue chip red shirt, but say, what about the guy you've got that's, you know, he's a room guy. He may get into the lineup his senior year, but burning a red shirt for one duel, maybe not. But okay, this guy, you know, we'll throw him in a dual meet here. You know, maybe the conferencing might limit that a little bit, but I can see it as being an opportunity to eliminate the forfeit when you've got a couple kids redshirting. You know, you've got one, you don't know, it's maybe the lesser of the two stars that you can get some mat time and avoid a forfeit too. I look at it as maybe this is good to avoid a forfeit, but what are some things that you could see? Well, one, I want to stop for a second. One, obviously, no postseason is kind of the caveat here. Because I think with football, you can still play in the bowl game, which is ridiculous. But remember, the NCAA does not sanction an FBS championship. It's not NCAA, it's the college football playoff. So whereas, no postseason there, people immediately started talking about, well, we could have five-time All-Americans. No. We don't want to do any of that.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, you've got, especially if you're on the road, you'll take an extra guy just in case somebody gets hurt and, making weight on the, you take 10 guys on the road trip, one guy gets hurt on the Friday duel, you're like, well, crap, we don't have anybody we can put in that lineup. Maybe you take an 11th that can plug in there. And, if it's a guy that you need to win a dual meter, if it's a guy just to avoid a forfeit, I think there's benefits to it, but,
I'll tell you this.
Go ahead.
Last year when we went to UVA and wrestled at UVA, we were in a situation, we ended up forfeiting the weight class. Brent Moore got really sick. He ended up making weight and weighing in but we weren't comfortable throwing him out there to wrestle in a conference duel, because of the way he was feeling, his illness. And so we had to make a decision. We weighed in Caden Darber, who, was a young guy here who I think has a future with us at Virginia Tech. And, I think in a couple of years can see significant time for us, and who knows, maybe better. But, we made the decision not to wrestle him and not to burn his red shirt for that very reason and forfeited the match. And quite honestly, it could have cost us the dual meet. I think as a coach, you're put in those situations a lot. We used basically what we thought was best for Caden, ultimately made that decision for us. But I think that happens more often than you think, and it would be nice to have that latitude. Obviously, that's a conference dual meet, so that kind of contradicts my point earlier, but I think it happens more often than you think, and it's definitely a good thing for the sport of wrestling, I think, over. I don't really see a lot of negatives as long as we put some stipulations on it and manage it properly.
Well, there's not a whole lot we can talk about other than, the ideas behind it. So we'll move on to some things that actually are impactful to this coming season in Division I wrestling that came out of the convention. Part of it was the discussion about regional training centers, which Virginia Tech has with the Southeast Regional Training Center, the dead period in recruiting, and the transfer rule. There's a lot of bad info floating around about the transfer rule. What is your understanding of it, and what do you realize is happening with this? It's not necessarily a free transfer.
Yeah, so I think there was a lot of misunderstanding or misinformation regarding the rule when it was released here, I think over a month or so ago. My understanding of the rule going into the coaches' convention was that kids would no longer need to receive a release from the school that they're attending to transfer. They call it the one-time transfer exception. And as it was explained to us by Greg Dane at the NCAA at the convention, is the only thing that they do not need permission for is permission to contact. So any athlete can come in, at least the way it used to be, and they'd have to even get permission to contact another school to talk about transferring. Then if they decided to transfer, they would have to get released or permission for the one-time transfer exception in order to go to that school and be able to be eligible and receive scholarship immediately. So the way that the rule changes now is that they can automatically put themselves in some type of database where they go to the compliance officer at the school, let them know that they're interested in seeking a transfer and they're interested in talking to other schools, at which time they don't need to receive permission to speak to the other schools. If they make the decision to transfer, they still would need to be released from that institution from the one-time transfer exception if they wanted to be eligible to wrestle immediately at the school that they're transferring to. So that's my understanding of it now. And it's, as I think a lot of wrestling coaches, nobody's trying to handcuff kids and keep them somewhere they're not, but we're also trying to avoid a situation where kids can just, it just gets out of hand with the transferring either. So I like the way the rule as it stands now, and for us, it really hasn't come into play a whole lot, but it's certainly a lot more clear than it was prior to the coaches' convention.
Other things that were discussed, I know that there was some real discussions about the haves and have-nots in college wrestling with the RTC model. What were some things that you picked up out of the RTC discussion?
Well, there's the Blue Ribbon Task Force that I think has looked hard at RTCs. I think one of the things that was discussed that kind of play into the RTCs a little bit is college coaches. You know, I think the RTCs are good in a lot of ways for wrestling, but there was some discussion about limiting college coaches coaching all these Fargo teams in these state, having a coach on the Pennsylvania State freestyle team from four different colleges. So there was, and it seemed to have a lot of people in favor of limiting that or no longer allowing coaches to coach those teams, sit in kids' corners in Fargo and for a lot of the other international events as well. But, as far as the RTCs are concerned, I don't think there's going to be a lot of changes with those anytime soon. I do think that they're trying to get a little more education out there for each school and their compliance offices just to make sure that the rules are understood and the rules are being followed as they pertain to high school prospects and the NCAA.
You know, it's interesting about the Fargo coaching thing, because I always thought that that was one of the cool things about Fargo is the knowledge that these college coaches can give even that third tier kid wrestling in Fargo, who's probably going to go 1-2 or 0-2 versus, they're in the corner for them just as much as they're in the corner for the super studs, even though the super studs are, out there more. I just think that the synergy between the college level and the high school level actually kind of blooms in that situation where these kids, I use my own experience all the time growing up, whereas I couldn't name a single Division I starter on any wrestling team in Virginia when I was in high school. And now, the kids that are out there wrestling, they get that opportunity and get to know them. So I do think that having the coaches out in Fargo on the state staffs is pretty cool, especially, you look at Pennsylvania with all the different schools that are there. You can have, or in Ohio, Jeff Brees has been on the job at Lake Erie College for like a month, and he was on the Ohio coaching staff there for a Division II school. So I can see the give and take on that one as well. Other things was the recruiting dead period. I wasn't really too up on this being a topic, but, what was discussed there?
Well, I think there's a lot of coaches that are right now, currently, we don't have a dead period at all for recruiting. Almost every other sport in the NCAA Division I landscape has at least a 2 week or whatever it may be period of time where you can have no on campus or off campus, or in some cases even communication with recruits. So I think it's something that needs to be done. If for nothing else, for the prospects, but more for coaches and for the profession, to have a period of time where they tell you that you can't go off campus and recruit, because otherwise it's, it's just the nature of the beast. And that's the way it works, is that if you think somebody out there is out working you, out recruiting you, that you're going to just nonstop be on the road and be recruiting all the time. So I think the NCAA putting something into place where they say, hey, whether it's the last 2 weeks of August or, sometime in June, maybe, where it's a dead period and you can't have any off-campus or on-campus contact with prospects is probably a good thing for coaches and their lifestyles and their families. And my wife would probably like it a lot. So I think it's a positive overall.
Yeah, it's like, hey, turn off your notifications on Twitter this week. No contact.
Exactly.
Of course, the kids might figure that out and just go crazy on. Never mind. It's, I don't know, the InstaFace, the Snapgram, I actually know what those things are. Actually, my biggest Instagram tweet of the week was actually the dandelion root that I pulled out of my front yard yesterday. Things like a foot and a half long. It's crazy. Anyway, we're not talking about yard work. We're talking about real work being done in the wrestling room at the Southeast Regional Training Center. Got a couple athletes that are going to be making world team appearances this summer and fall. Makai Lewis on the junior world team, David McFadden on the U23 team. Ty Walls has an international tour as he is on the senior national team. So, they're churning out there. You guys are working. What's the situation going to be like for these guys and their international tours coming up?
Well, I think it's been really positive for our program in the Southeast Regional Training Center, and as it relates to wrestling at Virginia Tech and really wrestling in this area. We've really opened it up, our doors up, to a lot of the high school kids who live within 250 miles of Blacksburg and of our location here at the Southeast Regional Training Center. So it's really I think just having these guys both make these teams, having Tyler Graff and Frank and Ty Walls all competing internationally, competing at the World Team Trials and the U.S. Open, and having Mackay and Dave on those teams has really, I think, emphasized the freestyle wrestling and the development aspect of our guys, our entire team, throughout the summer months and into the fall. And it's really been a positive thing. It's been pretty cool that both Dave and Mackay made the team and their training partners, and so they've been really spending a lot of time together, traveling together, training together on a daily basis with Frank and with Frey, and having our freestyle workouts. So it's been really good and positive, and we appreciate all the support that we've received from our donors that have generously supported the Southeast Regional Training Center since I was hired as the head coach. A lot of that wouldn't be possible without the support of our donors. So it's made a big impact on a lot of people, and these experiences that they're going to have internationally and being able to travel to Colorado Springs for our athletes, it's going to pay dividends, and I think it's going to certainly carry over into their folk style wrestling, and it's going to hopefully help them when we step onto the mat in Pittsburgh in March.
Staffing wise, we've got Mackay's going to Slovakia, McFadden's going to Romania, Ty's going to Belarus for the Medved. Who from the staff's going on these trips? Because we're looking as we get into McFadden's portion of the international tour. That's during the college season already.
Yeah, so Mackay is going to Coach Frayer is going to go with Mackay over to Slovakia, and then Coach Molinaro is going to travel with Dave in November to Romania for the U23 World Championships. Unfortunately, that falls on the same weekend that we're going to be wrestling at Missouri and at Northwestern, so we won't. Unless something changes, we won't have David McFadden for those dual meets. So, but at the end of the day, it's just a fantastic opportunity for him to win a world championship.
And as far as Ty Walls, you got a guy on the senior team. He's, how much has he developed, not just as a wrestler? We already know he's a pretty solid human being, but how has he developed since he's been officially part of the staff? I mean, he's got to be somebody that's no longer a teammate. He's got to be, a leader, a guy that the other wrestlers look up to. I mean, what's it like to be watching his progression from athlete to coach?
It's not surprising, I guess, is the best way for me to put it. When Ty was here as a student athlete, he was really more or less an extension of our coaching staff. I mean, he's always been a guy that's been willing to help anybody on the team, regardless of, if they were the second or third team guy at that weight class. So I'm not surprised. Ty's a student of the sport of wrestling. He's, incredibly focused on improving his lifestyle, his technique, his strategy. He's been fortunate enough to make the national team this year, so he's been able to spend a lot of time out in Colorado Springs. He's currently in California, just outside of San Diego, training out there for the World Team Training Camp. He's there for 2 weeks, then he leaves for Belarus, where he'll be gone for another week or so to compete in the Medved tournament over there, which, as you know, is one of the most competitive tournaments of the season, of the year, freestyle-wise. So everything that he's been able to bring back to camp, bring back from camp to Virginia Tech, whether it was technical, whether it was just strategy and training methods, really has been helpful for our guys and for our team. So it's been great. He's a huge part of our program and has been for a long time, and hopefully will be for a long time into the future.
Shifting gears, we got football season upcoming. Of course, this is a big time for Hokie Nation in the fall as Lane Stadium gets a rockin'. One of my favorite clips is going back watching the Miami highlight where they're playing Enter Sandman late in the fourth quarter, and then the broadcasters are like, "Are you looking at this right now?" So I know that football tailgates also have a big part of the integration with the boosters. And you don't need specifics right now, but where can some fans and donors of the SERTC and just general wrestling fans of Hokie Nation look forward to before football games this fall with Hokie wrestling?
Well, we're actually going to conduct the first ever Southeast Regional Training Center golf outing on September 7th, which is the day before our home opener against William & Mary. So for anybody that wants more information on the Southeast Regional Training Center golf outing, if you just go to southeastrtc.com, you can find all that information there on hole sponsorships, on how to sign up and pay for the golf. And then we're also going to make that our Virginia Tech alumni weekend, and we're going to host a tailgate across the street from Castle Coliseum on Saturday, post-game and pre-game. We're going to do a donor appreciation day for everybody that has given to the Southeast Regional Training Center over the course of the last year. Have a tailgate where we'll have snacks and beverages and a lot of camaraderie with our coaching staff and our athletes, and hopefully a lot of Virginia Tech wrestling alumni will be in attendance that weekend as well. So that's going to be a really busy weekend that we hope we get a lot of wrestling fans on campus. We'll have a workout that morning on the 8th that will be open for everybody to come in and watch and check out some of our new guys and spend the weekend with our coaches and athletes supporting the program. So it's a small way for us to say thank you to the more than 300 people that have given to the Southeast Regional Training Center over the course of the last year.
And we'll be sure to pick up information on that in future episodes and recap what's going on and also let you know what's coming up on future football tailgates. So Tony Robie, that's a good summer recap. I know we went over a lot of things. Information, of course, on this show at InsideVirginiaTechWrestling.com. Rate and review on Apple Podcasts. We're on every different medium you can think of. We've got Stitcher. We're on Spotify. I know a lot of people loving the Spotify these days. So you can find this podcast there as well. And Tony, we'll catch up with you next time on the next show.
Thanks, Jason. Good talking to you.
Hokie fans, listen to Inside Virginia Tech Wrestling anywhere you go by subscribing on Apple Podcasts. Go to InsideVirginiaTechWrestling.com/iTunes, or you can get the exclusive Android or iOS apps by going to InsideVirginiaTechWrestling.com.
This show is part of the Matt Talk Podcast Network. For more wrestling podcasts, head over to MattTalkOnline.com.